Hi guys, today I want to do just a little reflection on the feedback I've gotten over the last several years on my ergonomics of drumming videos, or my drum kit ergonomics series, which I'll link to up here. And this video, of course, will go in that playlist, but at the end probably. And I just wanted to reflect a little bit on the feedback, the criticism, and the sort of positive response. I've gotten plenty of both for that series of videos. So on the positive side, I've had a ton of people comment, email, message me on Facebook and say, wow, just one snippet of advice that you gave me was life-changing. It doesn't even have to be that they liked the entire series, but they found something in there they had never thought about, and wow, I just can't believe that I wasn't already doing that or never thought about that. So that's great that I've, I feel like I've helped some people. On the other hand, I've had some people absolutely think that everything I said was idiotic and, physically threaten me over it in some cases. So it goes both ways. So it's like a lot of people just do what they do and they really don't want to be told that they're wrong. Why they're watching the video in the first place, I'm not really sure. But once they saw that it wasn't what they were already doing, they just absolutely were not on board with what I had said. And that's fine, I guess, but then they get really angry about it because it's the internet, And I've had people tell me all kinds of crazy things, like that I really wasn't saying that they thought I was saying, so I wanted to dispel maybe a couple of the things that people assume that I'm saying that maybe I wasn't clear about or whatever. One thing that I think people didn't get is that I was exaggerating a lot of the time, a little bit of hyperbole, for dramatic effect. There isn't just one way to do it, and everything that wasn't exactly what I said isn't always wrong, right? There's a spectrum of correctness and what works. And another thing that people didn't maybe get is that I think a lot of people assumed that I was saying whatever I did on my drum set was the only correct way and that you should also do that. And I think that's definitely not true. The way I set up my drums would definitely not work for most people. I am above average height. I have above average arm span. I can reach things that you sitting there, unless you're over 6'4", probably can't reach. So my drum set would not work for you. But also, your drum set wouldn't work for me. I mean, if you're 5'1 and a jazz drummer and I'm 6'2 with unnaturally long arms and I play death metal, our drum sets are not supposed to look the same. They're not supposed to be set up the same way. That wouldn't even make any sense at all. Another thing people have a knee-jerk reaction to is I criticize in those videos a lot of professional, famous, good, a lot of people would say sort of top 10 or top 20 ever drummer setups. And they love the players playing, so they get all offended that I don't like the way they set up. And they think that a player who is really good at the drums is also really smart at how they use their equipment. And that's not always true. I really do stand by some of those criticisms, although they may be exaggerated for effect, like I said, because a lot of drummers really are susceptible to trends. They play what is fashionable, probably because they have endorsement deals, so they play what the company that they endorse recommends them to play, because of course they're getting it for free or very cheap and it's the newest thing, and so they gotta have it. But then they set it up in such a way that it looks like everybody else, even though these guys are all different sizes and shapes and they did play different types of music. So when I criticize a professional drummer, it's never about the sound that they're producing. It's about maybe some of those auxiliary choices that are influenced by their endorsement deals or by the trends of the time. And you see some of them stick to their guns on that stuff, and some of them evolve over time because they realize, okay, what I was playing 15, 20, 30 years ago isn't what I need today, and that's commendable. Like, it's good when they change their setup because that means they've identified something could be better or work better for the music that they're playing now, and that's great. But all that being said, if I see a pro drummer who's got a China cymbal 4 feet over their head, that would be way out of the frame here. But I'm going to say that, hey, I don't think that that's maybe the best place you could put that. It looks cool on stage. Maybe they think they like it there, but it's ridiculous. I mean, a normal drummer who's playing in their basement or whatever probably shouldn't have a China cymbal 4 feet over their head that they have to stand up to hit. You know what I mean? Like, that's basic logic, I think. I think one other thing that's maybe misconstrued a lot is when I say, like, I'm not a big fan of second floor toms, and especially not third floor toms. They're like, well, then how am I supposed to get 42 toms on my wraparound kit? Well, at some level, if you've got 42 toms, or however many, Terry Bozzio has, then some of them are going to be unergonomic. That's It's the reality of life. You can't make everything fit perfectly into the space where you can easily reach if you've got that much stuff. And if you really feel like you need that much stuff, yes, some compromise has to be made somewhere. But if you only have like a six-piece kit and you've got one of those six pieces somewhere you could never really reach it, that's sort of when you're like, well, you have plenty of room. You have actually not that big of a drum kit. Think about maybe putting it somewhere where you can actually get to it. Because as I've said in some of the other videos, you know, when you see like that third floor tom and the white coated head has literally not one stick mark on it, you gotta wonder if even that drummer who has that thinks, well, I need that tom because I'd really love to have that tom, but I can't reach it, so I'm never gonna play it. It's sort of a subconscious dilemma that they must have sort of somewhere. And then they set up the drum anyway. I don't really know what that's about, but that's, I guess, a personal choice. So to recap a little bit, my ergonomics videos, I stand by most of the points. I am exaggerating some of the time. I don't think everyone's drum kit should be the same, and that's absolutely not the point of the videos. I do think that some professional drummers set up very strangely, even for them and what they play and their body size. I think that you should always set up like you, not like your favorite pro, not like me, but like you, but in a way that you can reach things and that you're not hurting yourself to play. And if we can sort of agree on that, then everyone should be pretty happy. And if none of the tips that I gave work for you, that's fine. I'm not offended. But a lot of people, if you really think about it, try some stuff out, you can always put it back. But if it does work for you, then you've gained something. And that's sort of the point of the videos. And yes, I did make them intentionally inflammatory in some cases, just to get people to think, right? That's it for me today. Thanks for watching. See you guys next time.